Great and mighty God, we've come to adore Him. We've come to hear from Him. And so I am so thankful that you're able to make it, as well as those who are at home or who went away this holiday weekend and you're watching this later. So, or maybe even where you've gone for this weekend. That's one of the good things we can have about having us online as well. Just a couple reminders of just some ongoing ministries here through our church. Again, the Kings Creek Encourager, and that is where we're able to go into the school in ways of support, in ways of encouragement. And so there are still a couple opportunities if you've yet to sign up to say, hey, I want to be an encourager for a teacher. Again, just see myself. Better to see my wife. Also, if you've already signed up for that, she has some information. She's been walking around handing that out to those already, but if you haven't, she's got some things for you, name of whom you're praying for and encouraging. And so, again, we want to, and even if you aren't, quote, I'm an official connected with a teacher or staff member, just continue your prayers. For those again, very difficult situation in teaching. It's difficult for students, right? But it's very difficult for teachers in making it work as well. So, talked about this already. Seeing some in the basket in the back, soap that is there. That is what our county's collecting to join with the Women on Missions ministry to women in prison. And so, again, if you can bring that and deliver that, if you need to deliver that during the week, you do need to let us know, because we don't want to have a box out there and the sun hitting it and the soap not handling that well. So, the collection ends October the 11th. And then also, and it just seems so early, though it is nice to have a chill in the air, but there's also a coat drive through Caldwell Association. So bring coats that you've gone, oh, I don't wear this anymore, or for one reason or another. That collection ends mid-November. And so, again, opportunities we have. Now, during this month of September, and there are some of these sheets that are on the table where the offering box is, and just gives you kind of a, on the back side, gives you kind of a bullet list of here are some ministries that you support when you support North Carolina Missions through the North Carolina Missions offering. That is collected through the month of September, and so I encourage you to get that, and it just kind of lets you know how and who we're supporting. For instance, one of the biggest ways is through disaster relief, where teams go in to feed those who are facing the disaster, as well as those who are giving relief through the disaster. And so, again, pick one of these up on the way out as well. Wanted to go to our time for prayer and praying for one another. Let me go through a list. It's quite long, and you may have a couple additions as well. Some families to pray for. David McGee, who just lives down the road here. We've had ministry to he and his family in our homebound meals, but passed away. I'm not sure that was last night. And so please remember the family. Wanda, we are joining you in praying for Jason's family. Wander's brother-in-law, 37 years old, and passed away this week. And so remember. Laura, that lives next to Doug, because I try not to give last names, has a friend whose mother passed away. And so she asked for prayer for that family. Some other prayer needs. Travis will continue remembering your grandfather under hospice care. We pray, Wanda asked for us to pray for Kathy, We need to remember both Basil and Steve as they're recovering from surgeries, procedures. Remember Leslie, again, with her battle, ongoing battle with cancer. Remember Karen that's in here, Karen B, not Karen H. She mentioned a friend whose name is Paula, who has cancer and is facing stem cell transplant. So please keep Paula in your prayers. And then Peggy is having eye problems and seeing a specialist. And so let's remember Peggy this morning. She might even be watching us right now. Peggy, we're praying for you as well. Other prayer needs. That was quite a long list. Any other prayer needs this morning? Mark will be praying for you. Okay? And just... others this morning. Mike will continue to pray for you as you go back to the heart doctor for more stents. So, all right. All right. Well, let's pause. Would you close your eyes? And don't just rush into the throne of God and say, here's my list. But pause and just think that you are going to the one who made the universe by just speaking. The one who loved so much he sent his own son. Jesus who said, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden. Who invited us to come and cast our cares on him. So whatever it is that's burdened you here or at home, just pause right now. Think about the one who is great and mighty, the one we've come to adore. And then let's pray to him. God, we began saying we've come to adore you, to declare your greatness. And God, to be able now to come to the one who can do all things. That you are the God of all comfort, and we bring up David's family to you. We bring up Jason's family to you. We pray particularly for Wanda and her sister there. We pray for this mother that Laura has asked us to pray for. The family that you would just help Sharon and the rest of her family as they grieve. God, we pray, thanking you for successful surgeries, procedures. We continue to pray for Basil and Steve in that regard. We pray for Kathy and the needs there. We pray for Travis's grandfather, Hoover, his days, his hand, he is in your hands. We remember Leslie and the cancer she is battling. Again, you are greater than cancer. We pray also for Paula, Karen's friend. God, we pray for Trey as he is there in Louisiana helping restore power from the hurricane. We pray for Peggy and her eye problems. And again, you are the one who created the eye. Jesus, you were the one who multiply healed those who were blind. So we pray to you for Peggy. God, we pray for Mark and his needs and the burdens. And God, for everyone in this room, there are burdens. Whether they be people or circumstances, but we thank you that we can trust on you, our great and mighty God. And it's in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. What are they saying now? Yeah, you're right. It wasn't on. But thank you. I want to thank you, Riley, for doing that. And for those who've been home and watched, I mean, Sarah did it initially, and Riley's picked that up and helping people at home. Are you getting, they can hear me now? Good. Sounds like a Verizon commercial. All righty. So Romans chapter 14. How should we live? That's been the series since we began. From Romans chapter 12 and on. In fact, I keep putting Romans 12:1, and today won't be an exception up there, because in light of what God has done for us, how then should we live? Now, have you ever been in the room with someone who has a different opinion than you? Never, right? Now, it could be, now listen, I mean, we're talking about loved ones, we're talking about neighbors, we're talking about friends, schoolmates, work associates, we're talking about people in church not having the same opinion on things. Now, it could be something as light, now some would differ on this category. Someone may be rooting for the other team. And it could be stuff that we feel is a lot heavier. Someone's of a different political party. As I've been preparing and going through Romans, you know, it's been great, the timing of this. And I just think God has a word for us, that we need to rise above what everybody else does and how everybody else is when someone does not agree with where we have an opinion or a conviction on. And listen, that can be religious convictions as well. So we're going to be looking at that in this passage, and then how should we live? And let me just put up that passage. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy. And God's mercy is, we're not doing any of this so that we're right with God. God makes us right when we receive Christ as our Savior and Lord. So it's not about, here's a bigger list of here's what you have to do to be right with God. It's also just in view of His grace and what He's offered us freely. How then should we live? And we've been looking at so many areas. How should we live in this day and time? And it should be different, because verse 2 of Romans 12 talks about that we're not to be conformed to the pattern of this world. So how should we do this? We should, and here it is, we don't need a long list. We just need this one thing. We need to love. We need to love like Jesus loves. Now that we can't do without His power. And that's why the Holy Spirit is in us to give us power. But this is our one thing. This is the one thing that we're to remember, to love one another as Christ has loved us. And this goes to a whole bunch of things. In view of all that God has done for us, how should we live? And we looked at, how should we live with friends? Tell me. With love. See, I'm giving you the answers, but I do want you to respond. How are we to live with enemies? With love. How are we to live in relationship to governing officials? And with love. How are we to live in the last days? We are to live with love. I mean, as you watch the news, as you see anger, as you see all the things going on, what would happen if believers in Christ simply did this? What a stark difference. Instead of getting mad along and gripe about it like everybody else, we rise above it. And so, in view of God's grace toward us, how should we handle believers with different convictions, opinions? Do you know what the answer is? With love. And in the rest of Romans 14, two words. We're going to deal with one of them this week. Acceptance and care. We'll look at acceptance today. And so I'd like you, and as I've been doing, is just to start with just reading the passage as a whole that we're going to be looking. We're going to be reading chapter 14, verses 1 through verse 12. Accept him whose faith is weak without passing judgment on disputable matters. One man's faith allows him to eat everything, but another whose faith is weak eats only vegetables. The man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not, and the man who does not eat everything must not condemn the man who does, for God has accepted him. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To his own master he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. He who regards one day as special does so to the Lord. He who eats meat eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. And he who abstains does so to the Lord and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord. If we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. For this very reason, Christ died and returned to life, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. You then, why do you judge your brother? Or why do you look down on your brother? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat, as it is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will confess to God. So then, each of us will give an account of himself to God. Let's pray. Jesus, would you take your word, and as you said, he who has ears, let him hear. Holy Spirit, grant us ears to hear what you have to say to your church. We pray in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. So, in view of what God has done, in view of his mercy, in view of his love demonstrated to us, how are we to handle people that don't agree with us on certain issues? With acceptance. Now, here's what acceptance means. It does not mean, come on, I welcome you so I can influence you and make you agree with me ultimately. That's not acceptance. Acceptance is, I accept you. Whether you end up agreeing with me or not, I still accept you. Because that's what love does. Now, it mentions disputable matters. Accept him who is weak, whose faith is weak, without passing judgment on disputable matters. What are disputable matters? Well, let's see what are indisputable matters. What are indisputable matters? Without going into detail, clearly, it's clearly defined in Scripture as this is wrong, or the opposite, this is right. It's clear. If it says it's sin, it is sin. There's no dispute about it. There it is, black and white. And you know, for you to disagree, you're disagreeing with God, and there's no dispute there. So indisputable matters. What do we do with maybe a believer who is in sin? Well, we speak the truth in love. We're to go to that believer and in those who have a relationship with him to confront, because we love them enough. Now, so what are disputable matters? the things that aren't so clear. Listen, we Baptists are the worst about having a list of you can't. I think we're due a lot better, but I remember, you know, it used to be there were so many things that were on the list that says, well, you can't do this and you can't do that. You can't do this and you can't do that. And so, listen, dress. I'm talking about, you know, what only females should wear. But you know, what you wear and all that. What's the right length? What's the right this? Now, the Bible says, you know, modesty and things like that. But you know, there are certain people that go, if it's above the knee by 1 inch, or if it's below, I mean, and there's all sorts of details. And if it's not dressed, then you're really in trouble, you know, and all that. Or dance, you know, and it's like, you know, it's so funny. The Bible says to dance unto the Lord, and then, you know, you come to a church. You can't dance. Okay. Now, certain dances are not right because that is bringing other things on. But listen. You know, it's just so interesting. Entertainment. You know, we have all these little things. Well, you can't do, and all these other things. And here's my convictions, and they should be your convictions. So those are disputable matters. Now, you have also indisputable doctrine, teachings. I mean, do you not admit that there's things in the Bible where, you know, it's clear, you know, and this is important enough to die on? And then there's things in the Bible you're going, yeah, I'm not sure where that is. Let me just give you examples. So indisputable, the deity and humanity of Jesus. For faith in Christ, you have to believe in Christ. You have to believe He came and He died for us and He rose again and He is God's Son. Salvation is through faith in Christ alone. You know, that's how we become believers. So that's an indisputable. Where we view Scripture, is this just written by man? Or did God write through men? His very words. You know, I believe that's an indisputable doctrine. So this is the standard, not this. Now, you have disputable doctrine. Like what? Okay? Here's a couple things. End times. When is Jesus going to come? Is it going to be before? Is it going to be during? Is it going to be after? Is it going to be mid? Is it just a, you know, just poetic language? Is it, you know, all this other stuff? Listen, I feel pretty strongly on some of those. They say, no, it's definitely not that. But listen, we can disagree on that. And it's okay. Charismatic gifts. Do you do this anymore? Do you not do this anymore? How should you do this? How should you not? There's kind of a, I'm not sure. You know, sorry. We can disagree on that. Predestination or free will. Which is it? Where is it on the spectrum? I don't know. I've got some strong opinions on it. And maybe you do too. And that's security of the believer. Once you're saved, does God hold you? I really see some verses that say, definitely so. But you know, if you don't agree with me on that, I'm not going to break fellowship with you. It's not worth it. And I don't need to convince you to agree with me. I accept you. Now, we can go on and on about what's disputable and all that. I mean, here's an indisputable. What we talked about, what Romans chapter 13, 1 talked about, how we are to submit to our governing authorities. Okay, it's given. Boom, it's there it is, black and white. How does that apply with? And you can start going through a lot of disputable. I mean, in this room, and I'm going to bring up a subject that is a hot topic. Can I do that and not get mad? Mask. Some people wear them. Some people don't wear them. And I have some opinions on that, and so do you. But here at the end of the day, can we accept one another? Okay? That's where I stand on those things, in that it's not important enough to break fellowship. Now, accept him whose faith is weak without passing judgment on disputable matters. It gives an example. Okay, here's an example. Now, this example is a great example for first century church, but it's not so much a good example for us. Accept him whose faith is weak without passing judgment on disputable matters. One man's faith allows him to eat everything, but another man whose faith is weak eats only vegetables. Now, this is not talking about people who choose to be vegetarians. Okay, this is talking about in the first century where there were people who were very cautious about what they were allowing themselves to eat because they were afraid it was somehow contaminated by pagan ritual, things like that and stuff. And Paul has to address this to not just to the church of Rome, he also has to address this to the church in Corinthians and stuff like that. And so he's just like, listen, there's one person has this thing saying, hey, God's grace is here and all that. I could eat whatever. And I'm okay. Now, I might get to heaven sooner, but because of what I eat. But, you know, and then somebody's like, oh, no. Here's a list of what you can and can't. You know, and so he brings up an example of dietary rules. Now, here's some things to learn. Accept others where they are. Accept people where they are. He brings up this thing of those who are weak in the faith and those who are strong in the faith. Let me use this example so we can understand what is it talking about. Those who are strong, who are they, and those who are weak. When you have young children, you have to say don't quite a bit, don't you? They need guidance. Just one example. Don't cross the road. Now, for a two-year-old, don't ever cross the road, because a two-year-old probably is not responsible enough to cross the road safely. And so listen, don't cross the rule. Hard, fast rule. But one day that child grows up and now they're allowed to. What change? Maturity? Not needing that rule anymore because they were able to decide, make decisions because they were there. Until you're responsible enough to cross it safely. And so here it is. Weak in faith is this. Someone who's weak in faith need more guidance in what to do and not to do. Let's go into it a little more deeper. Guys, somehow my computer stopped. They live by a list. Here's my list of do's, and here's my list of don'ts. I must do this. I must go to church every Sunday. I must go every Wednesday. I must go to this. I must not go here. I can't do, and there's this long, long, long list that's continually growing of, because they're weak in their faith. They need guidance. Are they going to do the wrong thing? Those who are there tend to be legalistic. And here's what legal is. This is the difference between having your own list of do's and don'ts. It is this. My list should be your list. Because I think you shouldn't. Because I don't think I should. You shouldn't either. And this is the problem that Paul is addressing. Why are people weak in faith? Well, some are young in the faith. They're brand new believers. They need a little bit more guidance to get them started, just like a young child. But I think Paul is addressing more those who are stunted in their spiritual growth. What stunts people in their spiritual growth? Strong tradition. What's strong tradition? Where you've heard it said over and over and over again, not from the Bible, but maybe from a preacher, maybe from your parents or whatever. This is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong, or this is something you have to always do, and stuff like that. Now again, in Paul's day, the people who had this strong tradition were Jewish believers. I mean, they were told all their life, don't eat pork. And now they're around believers in Christ and they're eating pork. Ah, what do I do? Can I, you know, and stuff like that. And so there's this strong tradition that, listen, if you're raised all your life and you can't do certain activities because it's Sunday, you can't shake that easily. Strong tradition, poor teaching. Where you've been just taught to, here's your list, follow it. Instead of what we'll look at of what someone who is strong in the faith. Or maybe there's a particular weakness you have. One of the, and this is a hot topic, because listen, we can even disagree on our list of what should be on the don't do list. And all. Baptists have this thing. Thou shall not drink alcoholic beverages. Y'all been raised with that, right? Will you show me the Bible verse? Now, I can show you the Bible verses that says you're not to be drunk with wine. Now listen, do I drink alcoholic beverages? No. One, I just don't know if I might cross the line. I don't want to take that risk. I don't want to take a risk for my family. So I just abstain. That's my rule. But maybe you have a particular weakness and you don't need to go to a certain area like alcoholism or alcohol because you're maybe an alcoholic. You don't need to go, well, I'm free in Christ. You know, no. That's not, you're not free to sin. You're free to serve. So, what are those who are strong in faith? If it's not a list, because don't we want a list? Don't we just, God, would you just write what I'm supposed to do and not do and all that? No, you're guided more by love, loving as Christ loved you, and the Spirit of God. Listen, you don't need a list if you're letting love and the Spirit of God guide you. Because then you're not going to do the things that you shouldn't be doing. Now, Galatians 5:13 says this, you, my brothers, were called to be free, but don't use your freedom to indulge the sinful nature. Your freedom is not so, well, I can do things, and even if they're wrong, I'm free. No. You're to serve one another in love. That love is to be the guider. The Spirit. The more the Holy Spirit leads believers, the less they need rules. And this is what Paul says in Galatians. I say, live by the Spirit and you will not gratify the desires of your sinful nature. You're not going to need a long list of don'ts if you are walking with the Holy Spirit and following Him. Now listen, if you're not walking with the Holy Spirit and following Him, you probably need a list. Strong in the faith. I can eat pork. Yeehaw. Aren't you glad? Would you raise your hand? Aren't you glad that you can eat pork? Just about everybody and all that. But you know what? There may be somebody in here and they're just like, you know, I read that in the Old Testament. It says don't and all that. And so I decide not to. That's fine. That's fine. We're not going to shove it down your throat, okay? even though you like it. But here's the point. What is the opposite of acceptance? To look down on. The man who eats everything. Now, who are they? They're the strong in faith. The man who eats everything. Hey, oh, everything's fine. God made it. It's good. I could even find a Bible verse that says so. Even Jesus said that. I mean, you could, you know, the man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not. Oh, you pitiful, poor, weak Christian. Oh, if you were just like me, if you were just had the freedom I had, you would be so much better. Oh, if only you would believe what I believe. Politically, this way. Oh, you poor, you just don't know. That's looking down on your fellow believer. The man who eats everything must not look down. Another word is despise. You are less of a believer because you don't agree with me. The opposite is also to condemn. Here's where those who may be more weak, you need more guidance. The man who does not eat everything must not condemn the man who does. For God has accepted him. That's the tendency. If you're living by a list and you're seeing somebody not living by the list that you have, it's so easy to say, you're wrong. And judge them. The opposite of acceptance is looking down on and condemning, because both are rejecting those who Jesus accepts. And so we are to accept others where they are. We are to accept others for whose they are. Verse 4. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To his own master he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to stand. Listen. Whether I eat pork or not pork. Again, that's the bad example because everybody here is going, yay, pork. Okay, you know, but whatever the category is, who do I answer to? I will stand before God. I will stand before God. I will not stand before you. You will not stand before me. We need to leave it in God's hands. And see, He's the one who's able. Listen, if somebody may be off on something and maybe they're weak in that, I'm not saying you don't teach and all that, but again, you're still going to accept them even if they, at the end of the day, they still disagree with you. But you know, at the end of the day, God's going to make them stand. He's going to bring them where they need to be. We are all answerable to God. Now, it gives another example of disputable matters. One man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. Now listen, this gets a little bit more. I mean, let me ask, for a show of hands, how many were taught a bunch of things you could not do on Sundays? I remember my grandfather. He played solitaire. That's what I'm talking about when I say cards. He played solitaire and all this other stuff and all that. And I remember visiting him and all that, got out a deck of cards and all that, started to play, because he played a lot. He wasn't playing at the moment. He says, uh-oh, put those cards down. It's Sunday. I'm like, what? You know. And so, but it's just, that was where he was. And what you do on Sunday, what you can't do, or is it Saturday? And so he's just like, listen, and other passages of scripture you can look to in Colossians and stuff like that, it's just like, listen, this is just shadow stuff, this isn't the reality. Somebody holds one day and saying, this is special, and this is how I hold it special. And some people hold another day. Are all days to be special to the Lord? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. Now listen, listen. This is where the word conviction comes in. Conviction is a strongly held belief that impacts lifestyle. Meaning, I believe it so much, there's certain things I'm going to do and not do. These are my convictions. And maybe you have a conviction on Sundays and all that, and there's certain things you're going to do and not do and all that. That's great. Because here's something else that's true about convictions. Convictions are personal. Because this is where we can go wrong. This is what God wants me to do. And for whatever the list is, you know, regarding diets, regarding how do you celebrate a certain holiday, and are you allowed to use pumpkins, or are you allowed to do this, are you allowed to do that, and is the Sabbath, and all this other stuff, or what type of movie you can watch, well, one that has this rating, or maybe this that has these things, and all this stuff. I mean, we could go all day long about what's the... Hey, listen, at the end of the day, each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. This is where God has led me for this standard. That's convictions. Convictions are personal. And so we are to accept others where they are and for whose they are. They are the Lord's. And for why they do. It continues with this example of days and eating. He who regards one day as special... Why do they do that? He does so to the Lord. What's the why? I do this because it's just one way I worship Jesus. He who eats meat eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. Thank you, God, that I can eat this. And he who abstains also does it for the Lord. And he gives thanks to God too. Convictions are personal. Accept others for why they do, that we do. Motivations are what matter. I'm doing this unto the Lord. For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live to the Lord. If we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. And so what do we do every day in our life until our last day? We do unto the Lord, being fully convinced in your mind, this is what he wants me to do. For this very reason, Christ Jesus returned to life so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. You then, why do you judge your brother? Why do you look down on your brother? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat. See, here is Paul writing to this church that he has never been to, but he knows what churches can be like. Do we know what churches can be like? Listen, this is a message that I had to internalize first. It is so easy. Oh, don't they know? Oh, no, no, no. I'm judging. They should be doing it. They're going to stand before God, not me. As it is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me. Every tongue will confess to God. So then, each of us will give an account of himself to God. So wherever you find yourself on, you pick the topic. Hot topics like political stuff, hot practices of going, I'm not sure about it, if I can or can't. Listen, be fully convinced. We're going to read later on, if you cannot do it in faith, it is sin. That's next week. So, here's your assignment. Find somebody who doesn't agree with you about something. You don't even have to talk to them. And say, God, by your power, I accept them. They do not need to change for me. Because God, you accepted me. You let me come to you with all my garbage. And by faith in Christ alone, now you call me your child. God, help me to accept others, specifically, particularly, believers in Christ. Because God, you've already accepted them too. So Jesus, I pray. God, this is an area is so easy to fall into. God, help us to know what's indisputable and what's disputable. The things we can let go and let people be different and accept them as you have accepted us. Jesus, I pray for somebody who's either at home listening or in this room right now, that maybe their struggle with accepting others is their struggle to realize you've accepted them. That they still are working to gain approval. But because they've put their faith on you, Jesus, you have. You accept them. So help them to break that bondage and show it by accepting others. But God, my prayer is also for someone who does not know about that acceptance because they've never come to you, Jesus, in faith to receive you as Lord. God, they would begin there. That God, you sent your Son to die for us, to pay for our sin, so that you could accept us. So help those to trust on you, Jesus, alone for salvation.